Oh, companion cube. You're the only one who understands me. Oh! Hi everyone, it's That Funky Guy again, and we're gonna take a magical trip to the late 70s and early 80s!
Yes, that lovable time in television history where meddling kids ruled the airwaves, superheroes couldn't throw a punch, and parent watchdog groups were going out of their way to keep our children stupid and naive as long as possible.
In short, this was a bad period for TV animation. Animators were becoming desperate to come up with stuff to fill in all of the network's TV slots but still appease censors. And with the Scooby-Doo formula kind of getting old, they needed to come up with a new inventive thing. Which, unfortunately, not inventive, but what they ended up resorting to was making animated versions of live-action TV shows. That's right, animation studios made cartoons based on popular TV shows, and more often than not, got the original actors to reprise their roles. Some of these shows were pretty much just the same as the original show, except well animated. While others would take the characters in the original show's concept and put it into a new and wacky situation. Something usually insane and stupid like Partridge Family 2200 AD, or Fonz and the Happy Days gang traveling through time. But both of those are nothing compared to what we're gonna watch today, peeps. So grab your favorite sugary cereal and your favorite flavored vodka, because we're gonna watch Gilligan's Planet. Judging from the fact that Gilligan's Island is a timeless classic, I assume that you all already know about it. I don't need to... You don't know about Gilligan's Island. Internet, you're full of disappoint. Look, there's more things to life than Nyan Cat and Team Fortress. And yes, there's more than ponies, too. Gilligan's Island was a popular TV show. I guess let me fill you in and give you a little culture. Meanwhile, get some basic cable. Gilligan's Island was a popular TV series that ran from September 26, 1964 to September 4, 1967, about a group of moronic but lovable castaways marooned on a desert island. This includes tough but friendly Skipper, bungling dumbass Gilligan, rich jerkasses Thurston Howell and Lovely Howell, the highly intelligent Professor, who's smart enough to make a million things out of coconuts but not smart enough to get them off the island, sweet country girl Mary Ann, and sultry bombshell movie star Ginger. The show got solid ratings during its initial run, but ratings skyrocketed for the show when it started a rerun on syndication. Kinda like another show that will remain nameless. Anyways, Gilligan's Island had become a big part of the American pop culture, and thus it's been referenced and parodied in millions of different TV shows. Possibly the most referenced TV show in history. Well, most referenced sitcom in TV history, okay? As for Gilligan's Planet, it might be worth mentioning that Gilligan's Island was so popular that this was actually the second time that Filmation, yes, that Filmation, made a cartoon based on it. The first one was called The New Adventures of Gilligan and was exactly what you'd expect it to be. Gilligan's Island animated badly. Gilligan's Planet is, however, well, let's have the intro explain it for me.
We've got a brand new story about the castaways.
We left our tiny island after years and months and days.
We built a little spaceship. It's crude, but it could fly.
We left home and lost our way between the stars and sky.
We went from an island to a star, lost on Gilligan's Planet.
Oh, wonderful. The original cast is here to reprise their roles in this shit stain on TV history because, you know, they obviously didn't have anything better to do. Well, other than Tina Louise.
What riddles do we face?
What mysteries now haunt us? It is strange.
Strange,
enchanting place.
Our adventures are the best by far.
Here on Gilligan's Star Planet.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that's right. The lovable, moronic castaways of Gilligan's Island, who weren't able to repair their goddamn boat to get off the Celestia Forsaken Island, were able to make a goddamn spaceship out of fucking sticks and coconuts. Yes, they made this show. This exists. I don't want to believe it, but it does. God damn it. God damn it all to hell. I mean, I can kind of see someone being stupid enough to think, hey, let's put the Gilligan's Island cast on another planet and somehow think it's a good idea. Fine. The fact that Lou Scheimer also thought it was a good idea and produced this show, stretching it, but okay. The fact they got the original cast, though, I just can't believe it. I mean, no, not right now. We haven't even started the show yet. Anyways, point in case, I can't believe this was even made. Also, I'm going to say in advance that forgive me for some of the quality on these episodes being a little bit on the negative side, but these are like 2-decade-old tapes, so you can understand that things aren't going to be the best, so give me a little sympathy. Just me, not the show. And I only could find this one episode, so I'm hoping this is just a pilot. But let's give it a look. Paul Dini wrote this? Paul Dini? One of the big creative minds behind Batman the Animated Series, Paul Dini? Co-creator of Harley Quinn, Paul Dini? That Paul Dini? My God, I'm barely into this and my mind's already blown. So we start the episode with, oh God damn it! Why would you start an episode like this? No one wants to see Alan Hale Jr. naked, animated or not. I don't care if he's covered. Nobody needs to see that. I mean, well, I guess they're at least nice enough not to let us see the skipper's little buddy. So Gilligan comes in to see the skipper naked. I mean, to give him fresh bathing water. When he slips on a bar of soap and spills the water.
Gilligan, you're the only person who could make a sailor like me hate the water.
What the hell is that? He wasn't in the original show, but Wikipedia says his name is Bumper. He looks like a deformed inbred cousin of Spike from My Little Ponies. Whichever one you prefer. Bumper slips on the soap, causing him to accidentally swallow it, somehow. And then he evolves into a bubble bobble dragon. He'll turn into fruit! The skipper kicks Gilligan out of the house, and Ginger and Marianne talk about how the skipper has been awfully grumpy lately. The professor mentions that there's something shiny on the shore of the island across the sea from them. He says it might be shiny mica that they would need to replace the solar panels in their ship. There's no solar panels on that ship! Anyways, the professor says that there might be shiny thing something might help the ship with bullshit techno-babble crap. Gilligan mentions that the skipper could sail them over there if they had a boat. This is when the Hals decide to butt into the conversation.
Oh yes, we used to have the most darling little runabout back on Earth. What was it called, Thurston?
The Queen Mary, my love.
Wow, that's a rather crazy take on Jim Backus there. I mean, I can see Gilligan in this show being modeled after Bob Denver, and the skipper being modeled after Alan Hale Jr. The professor and Mr. Hale, though, are kind of insanely off and only vaguely look like the original characters at best. And Ginger's really off, but I'm sure that has to do with Tina Louise wanting nothing to do with this, which is why she's all of a sudden blonde instead of redhead, but whatever. But Mr. Hal is more hilarious to me because he kind of looks like what would happen if Jim Backus and Mr. Magoo had a baby together. And yes, I'm aware of how silly that statement is and, well, kind of ironic.
Yep.
The professor mentions they can possibly make a boat out of these lightweight volcanic slabs he found. That way they can both get to the island and possibly cheer up the skipper. Well, Gilligan hides in a plant and decides to watch the skipper sleep. Man, between walking in on him bathing and this, Gilligan is starting to feel like a major creeper. Gilligan tries to sneak away in his Cousin It outfit, but accidentally bumps into Marianne, who reminds him not to wake the skipper because the boat that they're building is supposed to be a surprise. Man, either they're building this boat really fast, or they've drugged the skipper to make him sleep for a really long time. Well, for whatever reason, Ginger gives Bumper a whistle to cheer him up because, you know, it's hard being a bubble dragon among a bunch of humans. Bumper looks at it confused, and Ginger informs him,
"All you gotta do is whistle."
So, let me get this straight. Your advice on how to use a whistle is to tell someone all you have to do is whistle. That's like telling someone to drive a car all they have to do is drive a car. That doesn't tell him anything. That's stupid. Well, I guess I can only assume that the reason Ginger said this is she's gotten into too many bad situations by saying that all you have to do is blow.
Oh, not so loud, honey.
Yeah, I bet Ginger's gotten in trouble telling guys that, too. Gilligan, realizing that Ginger was a moron to give Bumper a whistle and encourage him to whistle whenever they're trying to allow the skipper to sleep, quickly dons on his Sigmund the Sea Monster outfit and goes over to check the skipper, who had just woken up thanks to the whistle. Fortunately, Gilligan was able to put the skipper back to sleep thanks to the power of earmuffs! After creating a boat in record time, the cast reveals their surprise to the skipper, who's ecstatically happy about his new ship.
Wait, we cannot launch this elegant craft without the finishing touch. Lovey, if you would do the honors.
How chic!
Okay, why did they put a transition animation there? They didn't change locales, they didn't even move. They're in the exact same location, no time has passed. Don't get why they did that. I mean, why? The Hals try to send off Skipper's new boat the proper way, but Lovey is unable to break the bottle of champagne onto the boat.
Lovey, like this. Grasp firmly and swing it back.
What? That doesn't make any sense. Blowing on a whistle is not going to pop the cork out of the bottle. I mean, I could kind of see if he blew the whistle and it shattered the bottle. That would be a stretch, but at least it sort of makes sense. This just... That
makes no sense!
Oh, great! The clips are finishing my sentences for me now.
Cannot hide his thoughts from me.
Mother...
Come on, let's sail for the wild sea!
Oh, that sounds like fun.
Yeah, as long as there aren't any wild red sea serpents.
Gilligan, you have such a wild imagination.
What's so wild about that? You're on an uncharted, unknown planet. You don't know what's out there.
Life for me, Liana, dream of for me, but it ain't not that day.
Was that supposed to be singing? Maybe you might want to actually write some words rather than have Alan Hales say gibberish. Anyway, everyone marvels about how much better the skipper's attitude has been ever since they made him this new boat. And I'm sure most of you have already predicted by now, a big red sea serpent does in fact attack the ship.
Hey, Skipper, sea serpents are just made up. I mean, they aren't real.
Of course not, Gilligan.
Oh, that's good, because I'd hate to find out that thing chasing us was real.
Yow!
Herpy derpy doo! Well, the sea serpent makes a pass at Ginger, and the cast crash onto the island they're trying to reach.
I just thought of something funny.
What's that, Gilligan?
Well, first we were stuck on an island, and then we were stuck on a planet. Now we're stuck on an island on a planet. Funny, huh? Oh, boy.
Oh, the irony.
Oh, the pain. The pain.
Yeah, that too.
How does it look, Professor?
Not good, I'm afraid. It'll take some doing before the Minnow is seaworthy again.
I'm starting to get this faint feeling that the skipper shouldn't be allowed to captain anything. At all. The professor tells everyone the Maiko will have to wait because finding food is their first priority and tasks Gilligan and Mr. Howell to dig for oysters. Something Mr. Howell is completely against until the professor reminds him the oysters might have...
pearls? Well, what are we waiting for, my boy? Let's dig oysters. Now, remember, Gilligan, call out if you find something large, round, and pearly.
That just doesn't sound right. Anyways, to the surprise of Mr. Hal, Gilligan doesn't find pearls, but instead finds diamonds.
Better. Why, lad, I'm going to be rich. Of course, I'm already rich, but a little more never hurts, eh?
Well, it seems that the sea serpent isn't happy with them taking the diamonds and comes on shore to attack. That's the stupidest looking thing I've seen come out of the sea since sea ponies!
Shoo-be-doo, shoo-shoo-be-doo, call upon the sea ponies when you're in distress.
Wow!
Helpful as can be, ponies, simply sing your SOS.
Ah, no! No, go away! Anyway, the sea serpent chases after Gilligan, and lucky for Gilligan, the sea serpent is an idiot and tries to go under the oddly grown tree root and gets stuck. Herpy derpy doo! Mr. Hal shows off his diamonds, and the professor says that the diamonds are what he mistook for the mineral he was looking for. I don't see how he figured that out without taking a thorough look over the entire island, but I'm not questioning the logic on this damn show. I mean, it's Gilligan's planet, after all. Well, Bumper decides to be a dickhole and blow his whistle again, and after blowing out everyone's eardrums, he also causes baby sea serpents to hatch out of the diamonds? What the fuck is this? I don't even know anymore! So everyone realizes the sea serpent was only attacking them in an attempt to protect its eggs, so the skipper uses his superhuman strength to help the sea serpent. So to repay the skipper for freeing her from her Winnie the Pooh prison, the sea serpent gives Skipper and the rest of the castaways a ride back to camp across the sea, ending with the skipper getting some head.
Ugh.
Well, that was Gilligan's planet. How was it? Well, let's do the...
Wait! Hold it right there, crazy guy!
Who are you and what are you doing in my house?
I'm Lou Schreiber. I traveled from the past to the near future to warn you of a terrible mistake you're about to make.
Wait, you're from the past? Bullshit! Why would I believe such an insipid story as that?
Where do you think we learned our animation techniques, my young funky friend? I learned it by going to the future to learn something called Adobe Flash, where you animate things piece by piece rather than the whole thing, and adapted those to our animation techniques.
Actually, I can't argue that logic. How can I help you, Satan? I mean, Mr. Scheimer?
Oh, yes. Silly me. Your episode review of Gilligan's Planet is incorrect. It wasn't a single episode pilot. It was an entire series of 13 episodes that aired on CBS in 1982.
Objection! Why would I believe such a stupid series would be made? That's bullshit! Unless you've got proof, I won't believe such poppycock!
The other 12 episodes of Gilligan's Planet, of my wonderful series, prove that it exists.
No!
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 You owe it to them to review the entire series!
I don't think so.
6 episodes?
No.
3 episodes?
1 episode.
Okay, 1 more it is. So long, Mr. Guy.
If it wasn't mind-blowing enough that the episode we just watched exists, the fact they got the original cast exists, it seems that CBS bought 13 episodes of this infernal show as well. I have no words. But let's give another look to Gilligan's Planet.
Objection!
Oh god, this music sounds like a flute is raping a synthesizer. So Gilligan talks about the comic he's reading, Bumper is molesting a banana, and Mr. Hal is mocking the comic book Gilligan is reading.
Alien. Secret weapon.
Objection! I don't get this show's need to question the existence of alien life so much. I mean, for starters, they have a pet alien on this show. Second of all, they haven't fully explored the planet, so they don't know what all exists on it. Third, they're aliens on the planet! So by technicality, aliens do exist, and they should at least acknowledge that there's other aliens could exist too. This is just stupid.
I agree, Mr. Guy. In fact, I think my maid is an alien.
Really, sir?
Yes, she never showed me her work visa.
Well, the professor mentions that he needs to work on finishing the repairs on the ship, and everyone goes to force Bumper to do the dishes for them. Weird. I thought they were the illegal aliens, not Bumper. Anyway, everyone complains that the skipper didn't do his dishes, and he replies with,
"Women do dishes."
When did the skipper become such a misogynistic dickhole?
What's this important work you're always off doing anyway?
Wait, protecting us against alien invaders, that's what.
Skipper's real smart at it, too.
You tell him, little buddy.
He makes believe he's asleep on guard duty to fool the aliens.
Gilligan.
Our big, brave protector.
Great. So the skipper, who is the hardest working person on the island, the person who spent all of his time trying to keep the castaways happy and comfortable, is now a lying, lazy, misogynistic penis wrinkle. I mean, it's like they made him into a poor, fat version of Mr. Howell all of a sudden. Did the writers not see Gilligan's Island? Did they just look at Alan Hale and say, "Oh, he's fat, he must be lazy"? God, I hate this show. Man, is it just me or does everyone have lead feet in a Filmation cartoon? Yeah, like that! Well, the skipper feels the need to make his lie seem legitimate and asks Gilligan to dress up like an alien to help him scare the women and Mr. Howe. Gilligan agrees, but seemingly Gilligan has ADD because he decides to mess around with some alien plant instead. That plant looks familiar to me. Like I've seen it somewhere. I just can't put my finger on it.
Feed me, Seymour!
Nope. I got nothing. Well, fortunately for Gilligan, the plant is ticklish and the professor was able to save him. I wish I could say this was completely pointless, but unfortunately, it's not. Meanwhile, the skipper is off convincing everyone that they need his protection from aliens. Everyone is about to call his bluff when an actual alien appears. Skipper, of course, thinks it's Gilligan. But the women get more than a tad wary of the creature. Mr. Howell, on the other hand, seems to be checking the alien out. I mean, look at that face. What else could that be? Well, the alien kicks the skipper's ass and the women run for their lives. However, Mr. Howell thinks it's Gilligan as well and goes to shake his hand for kicking Skipper's ass. Man, what is with the sudden skipper hate in this show? Anyways, the alien then follows through with his ass-kicking of the skipper with an ass-kicking of Mr. Howell. Well, at least hating on Mr. Howell is more typical for the Gilligan universe. Gilligan finally arrives wearing the best alien disguise he could come up with, a fake nose and glasses. Well, at least he's not wearing a sombrero. The alien takes off Gilligan's fake nose and glasses and upon seeing his face gets scared and runs off. I guess the alien is allergic to pot smoke? You and me both, little buddy. Well, the castaways find the aliens and decide to watch them from the cliff above.
Now we'll know what they're really saying. Now this is a multilingual transmuter. Must have been left behind by some highly intelligent alien life. It translates any language into English.
There's so many things wrong with that statement. One, if it's alien technology, how would the professor know how to use it? And even if he did figure out how to use it, depending on how much time he's had, why would it translate into English? I mean, it would translate into, like, the language of that alien, which most likely would not be English. I mean, hell, everybody on our planet doesn't speak English. Hell, not even everybody in our country speaks English. So why would this alien translator translate into English? I give up. I'm getting a rage headache just trying to rationalize this.
What are these Earth creatures like?
How do these aliens know that the castaways are from Earth? They didn't find them on Earth. They found them on this planet. Oh God, why am I even trying? anyways, they mention they're interested in fat and dumb aliens, and thus are particularly interested in the skipper.
Let's go back to the compound and plan some way to arrange a meeting with them.
Hey, yes, we might be able to hire them to work for us.
Nice to know you support the hiring of illegal aliens, Mr. Howe. Well, the aliens kidnap the skipper by pulling him into a plant, and Bumper goes to get help, where the castaways decide to discuss it for a while, since it's easier to animate.
If those aliens come at me, I'll charge them.
Remember to charge some interest too, dear. Everything's so much more expensive these days.
And to think, they said this joke 30 years ago. Well, while the castaways continue to talk about the situation, we get to see the aliens put a wall of pixie dust, or maybe it's a force field, around the skipper, who feels the best action in this situation is to suck his thumb. Because we haven't demeaned his character enough in this show yet! Well, back with space family Gilligan, the castaways continue to discuss what they should do in order to save the skipper. Good thing the aliens don't seem to be in any hurry to do anything to him at the moment.
By George, we'll spare no expense in rescuing the skipper. Money is no object.
I'm afraid money means nothing to the aliens, Mr. Howell.
Then let's give them a check.
My God. This show's so bad, I almost thought that was actually a joke.
Well, seems Gilligan has left the camp to try and do something about the situation. It's sad when Gilligan is the one taking the initiative. The aliens discuss plans and... what the snot? The aliens using a sundial to fucking tell time? The aliens have the knowledge to make spacecrafts and force fields of pure pixie dust, and they have to use a fucking sundial? Not only does that not make sense, it just plain out doesn't work and is stupid. I mean, if they're traveling through space, every planet's going to have a different position around the goddamn sun, so the sundial won't be able to tell accurate time for their fucking planet. That doesn't work. Fuck this.
That's better. Continue. Gilligan and Bumper decide to dress themselves up as tree trunks to get on board, since, you know, aliens are entirely stupid, or maybe just stupid looking. Either way, the aliens get wise and we get a chase scene. Gilligan goes into the ship to save the skipper, and after a rather tiresome exchange, Gilligan not so quickly finds out why the skipper didn't just walk off the ship.
The air in an alien ship is sure strong.
That's an invisible force shield around me.
There's nothing particularly wrong with that statement. It's just not something I'd ever picture the skipper from Gilligan's Island ever say. I wouldn't imagine he'd even know what a force field was. I'd imagine him to say it'd be an invisible wall or something. It's just... seems really odd and out of place. But then again, I'm questioning the logic on a show called Gilligan's Planet, which means this alcohol isn't working. Well, since Gilligan's mom told him never to push buttons or some other bullshit, I just don't know anymore. Gilligan runs out of the ship to get the others, who I assume have been just discussing the situation this entire time.
Invisible force field, I'll check my books on that.
The professor has books on invisible force fields? Why would he have books on invisible force fields? When would he have access to such technology and information? That doesn't make any sense. No way she thought it. I just don't care anymore. I give up. Just say whatever you want, show. I don't care anymore. The castaways all go to the alien's landing spot to decide a plan of action, and Mr. Hal tries to figure out how to turn on the translator.
There. I knew I could do it. I didn't graduate the head of my class for nothing.
That's right, dear. It cost plenty. You had to buy the entire college.
Ha! Ha 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 ha. Well, the castaways decide that since the aliens are interested in fat and dumb people, that they need to make Gilligan fat since he's got the second part covered. I don't know how they plan to make Gilligan fat, and I don't really fucking care.
Hey, hey, hey! It's Bud Howard, and I'm gonna sing a song for you. And Bill's gonna show you a thing or two. You'll have some fun now with me and all the gang, learning from each other.
And the castaways run to the ship and save the skipper, but they are greeted by the alien cousin of Jane Jetson. It's up to Ginger to save everyone with a well-executed plan. Well, the castaways are all back together again, and the skipper continues to be a sexist jerk.
Listen, even in that alien world, the men were doing the hard work, and the woman was cleaning inside the ship.
Not quite right, Skipper. I just found a section on those aliens in my book.
So, the professor has books on aliens now? Sure, why not? Why not make it the Junior Woodchuck fucking guidebook while you're at it with all the sense you're making? Jesus.
Look, this is the woman. The one with the feather duster was the man.
Surprise!
Gosh, Skipper, maybe you should bring a feather duster with you on guard duty.
Yes, yes! Laugh at how horrible your career has gotten! Laugh!
Laugh with me, Jocko!
Well, that was Gilligan's planet. How was it? Well, let's do the That Funky Guy overview and find out. The goods? Well, if you like Gilligan's Island, you might get some enjoyment out of seeing some of your favorite characters in animated form and voiced by their original actors, even if some of the characters aren't portrayed correctly. It's also worth mentioning that Jim Backus, who plays Mr. Howe, was suffering Parkinson's disease pretty badly while he was working on this, so it's kind of cool to see how well he was able to do in the show despite his complications, and to see one of his last works, even if I wish his last work was something a lot better. The bads? Ugh, most everything. It is worth mentioning that this is a cartoon show about the Gilligan's Island cast accidentally crashing on another planet, so it's kinda doomed from the start. I mean, it's a terrible idea with an equally terrible writing and equally terrible animation. The fact Paul Dini wrote the first episode is almost enough to make me cry. Filmation's show is bad and they should feel bad too. Now, if you don't mind, I'm going to use this alcohol to erase all my memories of this cartoon ever existing. Oh. Alcohol soothes the pain.
An invisible force shield around.